Saturday Gaming. I'm your host, William Morris, and, you know, when it comes to top 10 Tales fact videos, yeah, eventually, you may consider that we might run out eventually, and unfortunately, looks like that happened to us. But luckily for us, we have a lot of you wonderful people in the comments to let us know about what Tales games you would like to see, and they don't necessarily have to be Mothership titles, and here we are.
Tales of Symphonia: Dawn of the New World was an escort title and the sequel to the very popular Tales of Symphonia. But the question is, was this game as beloved as the first one?
Well, time to find out. And before we get started, I promise, the Brotherhood of Gaming is all about tolerance, so I promise I won't make fun of the Tales of Symphonia fans or make fun of Tales of Symphonia.
We are the Brotherhood of Gaming.com, and these are the top 10 facts about Tales of Symphonia: Dawn of the New World.
Number 10. It was the first Tales game to appear on the Nintendo Wii. In 2003, Bandai Namco hit it big when they released Tales of Symphonia. You know it, I know it. It's old news. The game was a massive success, especially internationally, as the North American and European editions outperformed the Japan one. With it becoming the Tales series' biggest success in the West, they decided to bring its sequel to the Nintendo Wii in 2008. Which does make sense, the first game was a big hit on the Nintendo GameCube. Titled in Japan as Tales of Symphonia: Knight of Ratatosk, producer Teriyaka Konishi explained that they aimed to create a game set in the same world as the first, so that the fans can find out what happened to the popular characters, and that the Wii was the best place to do it. This game would be the first in the series to use motion capture. This would allow the characters to be remolded in a more realistic body proportioned manner. This would give the game a higher quality visual standpoint and make it more sophisticated overall, as compared to the first game.
Number 9. The battle system is called the Flex Range Element Enhanced LMBS. Just rolls right off the tongue. For the combat, the development team came up with the free LMBS, which is very similar to the Dimension Stride linear motion battle system from Tales of Innocence. When you go into battle, four characters are chosen, and those who are not controlled by the player are guided by the AI. When damage is dealt to an opponent, the unison gauge is filled. When this gauge is maxed out, the unison attack will be triggered. This allows the party to simultaneously attack a single enemy. When certain techniques are combined, a special attack can be performed for additional damage. Also, the two main characters, Emil and Marta, cannot be both out of the party at the same time. That at least one of them must be the first character. But you can switch the controller function to play as the other characters in the group. This game also introduces the elemental grid. This allows players to affect the dominant element of the battlefield, which depends on the skill uses. This affects everything from the effectiveness of attacks, which characters participate in unison attacks, and whether or not the monsters can be tamed at the end of a battle. Speaking of which...
Number 8. Somebody at Namco Bandai was a fan of Pokemon. Capturing monsters is a big part of the gameplay. To help this game stand out for the rest of the Tales crowd, Dawn of the New World adds a little wrinkle to the combat. This game gives you the ability to capture monsters that you come into conflict with. Here, you have the ability to collect, train, and evolve your monsters. Where have I heard this before? Not only will the monsters fight alongside your human characters, but they can also increase the powers and gain new skills. Cooking is also used as a way to increase their levels by making meals for them. Overall, there are more than 200 unique monsters that you can collect and evolve into different forms. Although, it is also possible for a monster to turn down their offer to join your team. And trust me, that's not a good time. Considering that Ratatosk is the lord of the monsters, it does make sense that this feature would be added. But truthfully, we personally just like sticking to the human cast as they were the ones that we were most invested in. I mean, if you think about it, what would you rather have? A team with Emil and Marta and the rest of them are just like your monsters that you collect? Or do you want to have the rest of the party members be the Tales of Symphonia 1 cast? Besides, if I feel like collecting monsters, I'll just take my cell phone out.
Number 7. Emil and Marta were originally named after the sun and the moon. The works of two popular artists would be seen here in this game. First, for the returning characters of the Symphonia cast would feature the designs of Kazuki Fujishima, and for the new characters, artist Daigo Okamura would create them. Among the new characters are Emil and Marta. At first, Emil is portrayed as a coward, but he makes a promise to defend Marta who is the keeper of the Ratatos core. Marta is shown as very passionate and a bit of a tomboy, and she really has the hots for Emil. Now, originally, the game designers wanted to name Marta Selene, who in Greek mythology was the goddess of the moon. This served as the exact opposite to Emil's original name, which was Selene. This word is French for sun. It looks like this naming convention was meant to be an opposite attract sort of a thing. They went so far to give Marta's original design black hair. We are not sure why this changed along the way. That's a shame, because it is pretty cute.
Number 6. There is no fully explorable field map. And boy does that suck. One major difference that you will see with this game as compared to others in the Tales of series, well, at least before Berseria came out, is that this game does away with the traditional format of player exploration. Nope, instead of traveling around on foot, this game instead has a point-and-click approach. Considering that this game was originally released on the Nintendo Wii, the developers wanted to take advantage of the Wii Remote, for some reason. And the point, drag, and click style was one way for them to do it. But they also stated that they tried to keep the functionality from interfering with the core gameplay. Uh-huh. Another big reason was also that the developers were forced to work on a limited schedule, so they felt the new, more compact interface would allow the game to flow between storytelling and battles much smoother. Were they correct? You be the judge. Let us know in the comments. So there was still plenty of fighting to be had in this game with the dungeons and the expansions that were made to them. And thankfully, you did not have to swing the Wii Remote around like an idiot for the combat, as it kept the traditional button pushing. Thank God. Trust me, I've played Soul Calibur Legends. It never works.
I swear to God, it doesn't work. The Demon Fang will not come out. I look like an asshole. It doesn't work! I swear, it doesn't work! Lloyd will not do the Demon Fang! It doesn't work! Technologically infeasible right now. This was not a good idea.
But still, traveling on a world map is an important element for the Tales games. And frankly, any good old-fashioned RPG for the most part. And this missing aspect was definitely felt here.
Number 5, it recycled elements from other Tales games. Due to the limited work schedule that the developers had, Dawn of the New World had some recycled as the developers had to cut some corners in order to make this game come out in time. Those cut corners do show up in the game's presentation. Unlike so many other Tales games, this one only had one fully animated segment, which was its opening. It was handled by good old Production IG. However, the rest of the story uses real-time cutscenes. Meanwhile, skits do make their return and are fully voiced to their credit, and this game is able to support widescreen. Speaking of recycling, many of the game's spell names, character animations, incantations, and a great deal of the monster designs are similar to Tales of the Abyss. This was because the game engine and mechanics were similar to it. And another element that came from previous games was its soundtrack. While it did contain some original tracks, most of the music was recycled from Symphonia. Also, just like the first game, the English version's theme song was reworked into an orchestral theme.
Number 4. The Western versions contain features not present in the Japanese version. Since Tales of Symphonia was such a success in territories outside of Japan, Bandai Namco was banking on Dawn of the New World to have the same kind of reach as well. So they added some more incentives for Western gamers to encourage a purchase. North American versions of the game had some features that were not included in the original Japanese release. These include the ability to load a cleared Symphonia game data to receive some extra items and gold, kind of like with Castlevania Lament of Innocence and Curse of Darkness. For European Tales fans, they got some new features exclusive to them. For them, they received a gallery mode. After beating the game once, the gallery mode is unlocked, which contains a skits library, an image library, illustrations, and pack art. Not to mention, the European release contains new head accessories for Emil and Marta. The player can use them to customize the characters, and in battle, this will give them special effects during conflicts. Sometimes, it pays to be a Tales player outside of Japan.
Number 3. Alice's monsters are named after the Three Musketeers. The main antagonists in this game go by the name of the Vanguard. There are several members in this organization, but one that really stands out is a young Alice. While at first looking young and sweet, she is actually quite cruel and mean. As the leader of the combat unit, Alice is described as a sadistic girl and takes delight in causing pain, such as creating a scar on Hawk's back and calling him his pet. She desires complete control and cares little for the welfare of others. In battle, while she does use arts thanks to her half-elf lineage, her primary method for dishing out pain is through the use of her monsters. In this game, there are three monsters that she uses, and their names come from a famous novel. The monsters' names are Athos, Porthos, and Aramis. And these names come directly from the main protagonist from the novel The Three Musketeers, which was written by Alexandre Dumas. Alice may be a little annoying brat, but that aspect of her is pretty neat.
Number 2. The game's theme song was performed by Misono. You know, it is a shame that this game kept a sad tradition from older English versions of Tales games. Like mentioned before, the original Japanese theme song was not included when it came to Western shores. So us living in the States and Europe missed out on it. If you do have a copy of Knight of Ratatosk, you can hear the opening theme song entitled Ninnin Sankyaku, or Three-Legged Race, or Two People, Three Legs. There is a reason it's called that, and you will see it when you play the game. Performing the song was singer-songwriter, or TV personality, Misono Koda. Born in Kyoto, Japan, it turns out music is in her blood because her older sister is also a singer named Koda Kumi. She made her musical debut in 2002 with the group Day After Tomorrow. However, she would make her solo debut by singing the song Verses, which was the theme song for the game Tales of the Tempest. Hey, you heard of it? Who knows, that might be the next fact video. Again, let us know in the comments below. Misono would actually go on to work on a series of songs that were used in the Tales of series.
And number 1, it received mediocre reviews, but strong sales. When it comes to Tales of Symphonia Dawn of the New World, it is important to keep in mind that this was a smaller game as compared to its mothership title cousins. This was just an escort title after all. With that being said, the reviews of this game were not very glowing. The best way to call the reviews of this game is average at best. While many felt that the game did a good job using the Wii hardware, it was overall felt to be a watered-down version of the first Tales of Symphonia. To critics, this game was also hampered by out-of-date graphics, dull characters, and was hurt by the lack of exploration. But like with the first game, Dawn of the New World benefited from being on a Nintendo console. With the console's wider audience, it still managed to sell pretty well. The game would sell 120,000 copies on the first day of Japan, and would eventually make it onto Nintendo's Everyone's Recommendation Selection list. In the end, this game definitely has its flaws, but if you are a fan of Tales of Symphonia, then Dawn of the New World is an adequate side story companion, and a way to spend more time with these beloved characters. It would even get the HD treatment when it was included in the Tales of Symphonia Chronicles pack in 2013. This bundle also included the original theme song as well.
This is a man sword right here. And that's our list. Make sure to leave a like and comment down below.
What did you guys think of it? Were there any facts that you thought of that we didn't cover or knew that we didn't, or maybe they were on this list? Let us know in the comments down below. Let us know your thoughts about Tales of Symphonia 2. Was it everything you hoped it was? Or was it just, Anyway, thank you guys for joining us. I'm William Morris. As always, you can let us know about other Tales games that are not necessarily Mothership games that you want us to cover in the next video, and we'll try to surprise you.
Hey there, everyone. Did you like this video? If you did, why not give us a thumbs up and maybe leave a comment and watch some more of our stuff? Also, if you really want to keep up with the Brotherhood of Gaming, such as myself, William Morris, or Eugene, you should really follow us on our Twitters, links provided below, so you can see what's coming up in the future. And since, you know, we have to play these games sometimes and record them, why not join us on our Twitch page where you can hang out with all of us as we do so and chit-chat about the games that we love so much. Lastly, if you want to help keep our dreams alive, you can support us any number of ways, either by continuing to view our videos, like them, share them with all your friends and family and your peeps and your girlfriends, or you can also join our small Patreon and throw all your spare cash away. We'll even give you a shout-out. Once again, thank you all, and have a wonderful day.